begin by singing our opening hymn, Savior, When in Dust to Thee, hymn number 419.
Deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you and for his sake forgives you all your sins. As a called and instrument of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Vindicate me, O God, and defend my cause against an ungodly people. From the deceitful and the unjust man, deliver me. I love the Lord, because he has heard my voice and my pleas for mercy. Because he inclined his ear to me, therefore I will call on him as long as I live. The snares of death encompassed me, the pangs of Sheol that hold on me. I suffered distress and anguish. Then I called on the name of the Lord. O Lord, I pray, deliver my soul. For you have delivered my soul from death, my eyes from tears, my feet from stumbling. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Vindicate me, O God, and defend my cause against an ungodly people. From the deceitful and unjust man, deliver me. In peace let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace from above and for our salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For this holy house and for all who offer here the worship and prayers, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Help, save, comfort, and defend this gracious Lord. Sacrifices for sins. He can deal gently with the ignorant and wayward, since he himself is beset with weakness. Because of this, he is obligated to offer sacrifice for his own sin, just as he does for those of the people. And no one takes this honor for himself, but only when called by God, just as Aaron was. So also Christ did not exalt himself to be made a high priest, but was appointed by him who said to him, "You are my son, today I have begotten you." As he says also in another place, "You are a priest forever after the order of Melchizedek." In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to him who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverence. Although he was a son, he learned obedience through what he suffered, and being made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation to all who obey him, being designated by God high priest after the order of Melchizedek. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Now I invite you to rise for the reading of the Holy Gospel and the singing of the Lenten verse.
Thank you.
God our Father, our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. The word of the Lord from St. Mark's Spirit-inspired gospel declares, the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. For those whom the Lord has brought to faith, for those whom the Lord has bestowed new and eternal life, when they hear this word of the Lord, they are moved to give hearty and humble thanks because they know the events and work of the Lord to which this text testifies. They have been enabled by the Spirit to understand these words of the Lord in their proper context. But for the disciples, though, at that particular time when they were first spoken, they failed to grasp their significance. Jesus has been teaching them about the fulfillments of God's word. Indeed, they readily admit and confess that Jesus is the long-awaited promised Messiah, the one who was first prophesied about in the Garden of Eden. In fact, they've been eyewitnesses to many wonders and miracles. They witnessed Jesus perform healings, casting out demons from the afflicted, feeding thousands from a couple of fish and a few loaves of bread. They even witnessed Jesus walking on water, demonstrating his authority over creation. You might say that following Jesus up to this point has been pretty easy and enjoyable. But over the course of the previous weeks, Jesus' teaching had taken on a more somber tone. Chapters 8 and 9, Jesus says he must suffer and die. Peter even tries to stop Jesus from talking about such things, thus thwarting him from fulfilling the purpose of his becoming man, prompting Jesus to exclaim, "Get behind me, Satan, for you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man." Jesus went on to teach his disciples that if anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. Death, suffering, taking up crosses, a somber message indeed. Our text. And they were on the road going up to Jerusalem. Jesus was walking ahead of them. And they were amazed, and they who followed were afraid. And taking the 12 again, he began to tell them what was to happen to him, saying, "See, we are going up to Jerusalem, and the Son of Man will be delivered over to the chief priests and the scribes. They will condemn him to death. They will deliver him over to the Gentiles, and they will mock him, and spit on him, and flog him, and kill him. And after 3 days, he will rise." Jesus is declaring the truth, but he's doing so to prepare them for what lies ahead when he will be turned over to the ruling elite to suffer and die, serving as the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world. We get a glimpse of just how difficult the reality of this truth was for Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane. According to his humanity, Jesus earnestly prays as he considers all that lies before him, culminating in his plea, "O Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. Nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will." Such glimpses declare Jesus' full humanity, while at the same time fully being God. When you factor in what he is contemplating that he must do, accept the sins of the world and suffer for them upon the cross, to give that sacrifice, to atone, to suffer God's judgment for sin, to this God-man, it was almost too much to take, too much to endure. There's something else you should consider regarding Jesus as he prays in Gethsemane. For the verses that precede and follow our epistle lesson, as Jesus prays, he is in reality serving in his office as our great high priest. In other words, like an Old Testament high priest, Jesus is interceding on behalf of those he served. He is standing between man and God and praying on man's behalf. Or as the author of Hebrews was inspired to write, "For priest is appointed to act on behalf of men in relation to God to offer gifts and sacrifices for sins. The following day, as our great high priest, he offers the sacrifice that all other sacrifices pointed to. He offers himself as atonement for the sins of the world. The Hebrews text also relates that God the Father hears his son's prayer. He doesn't hear them because of Jesus' vehemence or earnestness or sincerity. God doesn't hear his prayers because of the quality and quantity of his tears shed for those he's interceding for. God hears Jesus' prayers because of his godly fear. Or in other words, God hears Jesus pray because Jesus prays according to God's word. Rather than demand that his Father's word to work things according to his own desires, Jesus prays that the Father would work them according to his will. The Father's will. According to his promises. According to his word of truth. Thus Jesus prays, nevertheless, not as I will, but as you will. God the Father hears his prayers and supplications, and he doesn't ignore his Son. But in order to fulfill his promises, especially the one first spoken in the Garden of Eden so as to crush Satan's head, he permits the Lord to endure, to go the full measure, if you will. And although he was a son, Jesus that is, he learned obedience through what he suffered, obeying. Stop and think, as you obey, you also learn obedience in suffering. As you obey God and his word of truth, as you live out your faith in this fallen world, endure the cross that is placed upon you, indeed you learn obedience even in suffering. And according to God's will, Jesus suffers and dies on your behalf. But it's also his Father's will to raise him from the dead after. And there's a reason for all of this. Being made perfect, he became the source of eternal salvation to all who obey him, being designated by God a high priest. Perfect. It's the same word as fulfilled. So having fulfilled or perfected God's plan for salvation, he is the author, the source of eternal salvation to all who obey. But what does it mean to obey Jesus? To keep and submit to his law, most certainly, but we know that we can never do that perfectly. Thus we obey his command as in true faith. We humbly repent of our sins every day. Fellow redeemed, I hope you see that what the Lord commands, he provides. You see, by his grace, we are enabled to repent in true faith and to believe in him. To believe all of that, that it is his work, that it is his doing. He also moves us to pray. And as a child of God, he moves you to talk to him as your Father in heaven. To bring your needs and your desires, your intercessions for others even to him. And just as he did with his only begotten Son, your prayers. Throughout my life, I've often felt that my prayers at times were not worthy for God to hear them. And based upon who I am apart from Christ, truth is, they aren't worthy to be heard. Our prayers are not good enough. But for the sake of Christ Jesus, your great high priest, through faith in him, they are sanctified. They are made holy and acceptable to our Heavenly Father. Garden, Jesus is in essence praying for you and interceding for you. Even now, he continues to do the same, ascended on high. For in Hebrews 7, we hear, he is also able to serve to the uttermost those who come to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. So when you pray, it is as if the Son of God says to the Father, Father, I died for this one. I made him yours in baptism. Therefore, hear the prayer of this one, your redeemed child. He intercedes on your behalf. This is why prayer begins with confidence that God hears your prayers for Jesus' sake. Not for your own. Not because of your merits, but because of Jesus' merits. This enables you then to pray knowing with certainty that Jesus is interceding for you as your great high priest. He doesn't hear your prayers because you're more articulate. Or as I've been accused of, being verbose than others. He doesn't hear your prayers because you're passionate and filled with emotion. He doesn't hear your prayers because of your cries or tears. He hears them for Jesus' sake. So that you may be certain and sure that he does. This is why it's so fitting to end your prayers with, in Jesus' name, or for Jesus' sake. Because he is why God hears your prayer. A fellow pastor once shared some dangers regarding prayer that kind of stuck with me after I heard him. He said that praying not as I will, but thy will be done isn't easy. Tempted by the old Adam, you want your will to be done. You want your sins to be permissible because you enjoy them. You want deliverance to come according to your timetable, not his. You want your struggles to stop right now. This patience thing, he better give it to you right now. Working through things in your own mind, you have a pretty good idea of what you want the Lord to do. So praying thy will be done will always be difficult because you're afraid of what sacrifice for your sin. He suffered in the wilderness on your behalf. He knows what you face. And God promises that his will be what is best for you. So that you know that all things work together for good to those who love God, to those who are called according to his purpose. All things. That's a tough one. There's also something else you need to remember. When you do not know what to pray for, he does. And he readily intercedes for you. But we also acknowledge that there have been those times that Pastor had related before, that our sins have indeed been selfish. And for such, we repent of that selfishness. We repent of our distrust of God's truth. We repent for those times that we have not truly feared him. And we rejoice and give thanks in the forgiveness that he so willingly shared with us. Not merited, we are unworthy of such great gifts. But out of his mercy, he showers us with them. He showers us with his grace, his mercy, the gift of forgiveness, renewal, and indeed, life. And having repented of our sins, having confessed that our acknowledging that our Lord is working all things for our good, we're now ready to learn some of the reasons that he permits trials to linger at times. Why he kind of holds off deliverance, or when it appears to be slow in our eyes, but in actuality is perfect for our good. You see, the Lord permits such according to his perfect wisdom, so that we might learn obedience from the things which we do suffer. What do such things remind us of? What do illnesses remind us of? Our sin. That we live in a fallen world, that we're surrounded by evil all around us. We are in need of God's presence and his sustaining comfort. They also serve to remind us that Jesus has perfectly, as the Son of God, learned obedience from suffering. And so why would disobedient children like us be exempt from such? He is our teacher. It should model that we, as his students, will follow in that step. You see, suffering often reveals potential idols and false gods in our eyes or our lives, such as health, wealth, and prosperity. So that in true heartfelt repentance, we might rejoice in his mercy rather than trust in those things which cannot help us. Our Lord teaches us during such times true obedience so that we rediscover that our worth and identity is not found in anything other than Christ who has redeemed us by his blood. We must admit we cannot tell for sure why God permits a particular suffering or why he answers some of your prayers with no or wait. There is something of which we can be absolutely certain and sure. You are his beloved child for Jesus' sake, and he will deliver you. In the meantime, he encourages you to pray in all circumstances. When Holy Week nears, we will once again hear of the Lord's passion for us and for our sake. On Maundy Thursday, we will once again hear of Jesus' prayers in the garden. We will once again consider that he, as our great high priest, even in that garden, struggled, but was at work for us, regardless of that struggle. Our Redeemer, Savior, prays for you and intercedes for you. Before he was sacrificed upon the cross so that he could rise or would rise again and intercede for you, seated by the Heavenly Father, declares, "Therefore, since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which so easily ensnares us, and let us run with endurance the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and has sat down at the right hand of the throne of God." All for you. He is the author and perfecter of your faith. For his sake, you are a child of God. And as a child of God, you are the focal point for the Father. And for Jesus' sake, God's will for you is always good. Even in the midst of heartache, suffering, and trials. For Jesus' sake, God the Father hears your prayers, and he indeed promises to answer them, not according to your will, but according to his, knowing what is best for you. For Jesus' sake, because of his life, death, resurrection, and ascension, you know that your sins are forgiven. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Now may the peace of God that surpasses all understanding keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
And at this time, I invite you to rise and we continue by professing the Christian faith in the words of the Nicene Creed.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men, and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and the giver of life,
who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us pray for the whole Church of Christ, that, O Lord God, we defend her against all the assaults and temptations of the adversary. Holy God, holy and mighty, holy and immortal, have mercy upon us. You have revealed Jesus Christ alone to be the way, the truth, and the life. Protect your church from the temptation to compromise this message of salvation, as well as from the temptation to remain silent, that your pure word, passionately proclaimed and guided by the Holy Spirit, may be an occasion for all nations to worship and praise you in this life and in life and life to come. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious Heavenly Father, who have called us to pray to you as dear children, ask their dear Father, hear us for the sake of your Son, who fulfilled his vocation by his atoning death upon the cross and by his giving resurrection. Bless and guide all who preach and all who hear, that your redeemed children in their varied callings of life may serve you by serving their neighbor. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, strengthen the faith of all who study your holy word, that your disciples may rejoice in the gift of the washing of rebirth and renewal in the Holy Spirit, the sacrament of holy baptism, and in lives of repentance, faith, and holiness we live before you. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Almighty Father, grant wisdom to our President, the Congress and Judiciary of the United States, our Governor, and all who make, administer, and judge our law. Guide them by your unchanging word of truth, so that all who receive the sword as your servants and avengers may bear it according to your will, and for the safety and temporal blessings of those you have given them to serve, so that they may lead a quiet and peaceful life in all godliness and honesty. Deliver the world from all terror. Take away disease. Ward off famine. Set free those in bondage. Grant health to the sick. And safe journey to all who travel. And have mercy upon all who call upon you in their time of need, especially Rosalie and the death of her sister-in-law, Barbara Stenberg. Assist us to ever prepare for our final summons, when we will depart and be with Christ in blessedness and glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious God, we thank you for hearing and answering the prayers of Felicity and Peter by granting them the gift of a child. At all times, let them see in this child an undeserved gift from your loving hand. Strengthen them and all who bear the sign of the cross to be teachers and examples of Christian faith to this child. And by the gracious leading of your Holy Spirit, fulfill what we are unable to do. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Your word reminds us that no one may approach you except through Jesus Christ. Strengthen all who call upon you in Jesus' name. Where there are errors among those who profess to be Christians, purge them. Reform all occasions of compromise from the purity of your word. Deliver all who dwell in darkness and in the shadow of death. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious Lord, grant us peace with you because of Jesus, the Prince of Peace. Help us to be and to remain at peace with all who will be at peace with us. Turn the hearts of all who would persecute us for your name's sake, so that they too may be enabled to confess you as Lord and Savior. Enable all in the body of Christ to bear with one another in love. Grant that we would not return evil for evil. Grant us true unity, and that we may, or all may have the mind of Christ. And grant us the peace that surpasses all understanding. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
O Lord, graciously receive our prayers, deliver and preserve us. Remember not our sins, forgive, renew, and strengthen us to fight the good fight of faith. And protect us from the assaults and temptations of the devil, the world, and even our own sinful flesh. Practice true repentance and faith, holy lives to match godly intentions, and perseverance until you return or call us home. For to you alone we give all glory, honor, and worship, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Amen.
At this time, while the instrumental offertory plays, I will prepare for the sacrament.
Trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us.
and lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our Lord Jesus Christ, in the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take it. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." The same way also he took a cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament of my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always.
Amen. Lamb of God, you take
your word has been fulfilled. My own eyes have seen the salvation which you have prepared in the sight of every people, a light to reveal to the nations and the glory of your people Israel. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen.
And let us pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us with a salutary gift. And we implore you, God, your mercy, you would strengthen us with the same in faith toward you, and fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord look upon you with favor and give you peace.
Amen.
You may be seated. We continue by singing our closing hymn, Why Should Cross and Trial Grieve Me, hymn number 756.
Pray.